Bishop Jeremiah, or Reverend Jeremiah Wright in Chicago, Barack Obama's pastor, just went off on the deep end because he was preaching something other than the gospel in the pulpit. And he made statements about Bill and Hillary Clinton and that they did not do anything for the black community. I don't know what they did. I was not looking for Bill and Hillary Clinton to do nothing for me. But they went on, and then he said they only did to the black community what Bill did to Monica Lewinsky under his desk in his office, and then he started humping in the pulpit. Now, this is completely an abomination. This is behavior beyond pale. He never should have done this. This is now being shown all over the country, internationally, and, of course, this is going to cost Barack Obama significantly. If you don't think that is going to cost him, you just watch the numbers. As this gets out there and is used by the pundits, which it should be and would be and shall be and must be, because this is how politics works, it is going to cost him. And remember now, it's not over yet anyway, but if there ever was going to be something to fortify those who are his competition and are in contention with him, it will be the remarks of this man, who, because of some flippant remark, and then he sold the tapes in a package. And that's all they did. The media purchased the tapes and just played what he put out there. If you put it out there, then this is what it is. Can the church say amen? But this is not the church. He does not represent the church. He represents a religious denomination and refers to themselves as Christians. Certainly he does not speak for everyone who may be sincere in his congregation. His position of accepting gays and lesbians in his church is an abomination and contrary to the word of God. And I'm saying this so it gets on the internet, so people who pick me up on YouTube know that the scripture categorically condemns such ungodly behavior. I say now that he has retired from the pulpit, that he has turned the church over. No doubt this is a strategic move for political reasons or whatever it is for. But that is not the church. Turn to someone and say, that ain't the church. That is not the behavior of the church. And so understand, even though they are putting themselves out there to be representatives of the Christian community, this is not so. And there are those who are imposters. Now, they may have some level of theological acceptance of Christian doctrine, but they certainly aren't representing. And Jeremiah Wright is not preaching any gospel as we know it. The death, burial, resurrection, and ascension of Jesus Christ is without Afrocentrism. There's no Afrocentrism in that particular message. This is what he prides himself in, being an Afrocentric preacher. Well, the Bible says, have not the faith of our Lord Jesus Christ with respects of persons, because respect to persons is sin. Any gospel that promotes a culture or a ethnicity or a race or a people above another is a false gospel. The unadulterated gospel is colorblind, and it does not discriminate. This is why Paul said in Romans 1:16, for I am not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believeth, to the Jew first and also to the Greek. For therein is the righteousness of God revealed from faith to faith, as it is written, the just shall live by faith. What are you saying? That is, Paul was making the statement that he was not ashamed of the gospel because it did not discriminate. It is to the Jew first and also to the Gentile. That means it's to everyone. And the righteousness of God is revealed in a gospel that does not discriminate against anyone for any purpose. It does not discriminate against the homosexual. The homosexual must repent too. Can we say amen? Doesn't discriminate against the lesbian. The lesbian must repent too. The whoremonger must repent. The liar, the self-righteous person, the black man, the white man, the red man, the brown man, the yellow man, whatever color a person may be, whatever their background may be, the intellectual, the fool, the rich man, the poor man, whoever you may be, the gospel calls for every man, every woman, every person, everywhere to do what? To repent. So in verse number 2 of the 3rd chapter of 2 Corinthians, for ye are our letter written in our hearts, known and read of all men. Verse 3, For as much as ye are manifestly declared to be the epistle of Christ ministered by us. So now then, what happens with the ministry of the church today? We speak the word to you. You receive it, believe it, obey it. It is written in your heart. He takes out the heart of stone, puts in the heart of flesh. After you've heard, believed, and obeyed the gospel, he's granted you the gift of repentance, the gift of faith, the gift of the Holy Ghost, baptized in water in Jesus' name. Your sins are washed away. You're placed in the body of Christ. And now God begins to manifest in you through word and deed, through your behavior and lifestyle, his word. So he says, for as much as ye are manifestly declared to be the epistle or the letter of Christ ministered by us, the apostles or the apostolic ministry ministers to you, and then as you receive and believe the word then is manifested to others. People see the life of Christ in you as a Christian, as a New Testament member of the New Testament church, as a New Testament church believer. Can the church say amen? So you may want to go out and party. Turn to someone and say, you may want to go out and party, but you'll take a whipping for it. Because when you go astray as one of the children of God, he will discipline his children. The Bible says he chastens every son that cometh to him. So wanting, becoming a son of God and saying, I'm tired of being a son of God. I want to go out. I want to get out here and enjoy life, is the spirit of the prodigal son. It is in the Bible as a parable. It is the spirit of the prodigal son. You are picking up a prodigal spirit, a prodigal disposition, dissatisfied with being in your father's house, wanting to get out and do your own thing. Well, we didn't get saved to do our own thing. We got saved to do God's thing. And that's what you're supposed to be saved to do, do God's will. Can the church say amen? So now, for as much as ye are manifestly declared to be the epistle of Christ ministered by us. Let us continue that verse and finish it. Read. Written not with ink, but with the spirit of the living God, not in tables of stone, but in fleshly tables of the heart. And this means that it is now written in the resolve. Someone say, it is written in my resolve. It now becomes written in the resolve of the believer. I am resolved what to do. I'm not staying home. I'm going to church. I am resolved what to do. I'm not going to curse. I'm going to pray. I am resolved what to do. I'm not going to become anxious. I'm going to wait on the Lord. I am resolved what to do. I'm not going to take a gun and straighten the matter out. I'm going to trust in the Lord with all my heart and lean not to my own understanding. In all my ways, I'm going to acknowledge him, and he shall. I am resolved what to do. I'm not going to fight physically. I'm going to turn the other cheek, and as soon as she hits me, I'm calling the police. Can the church say amen? And pressing charges. That's right. I am resolved what to do. I am going to do what the scripture says do. When it is in the heart of the believer, it becomes a part of our resolve. We draw the finality of our conclusions based on the scripture. Yes, I was done wrong, but I'm not going to be overcome of evil. I'm going to overcome evil with good, because he said, vengeance is mine. I will repay, saith the Lord. I am resolved what to do. I will suffer evil rather than perpetrate evil. I am resolved what to do. I will pay my vows in the presence of all of his people. Amen. I am resolved what to do. Can the church say amen? I will walk not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor stand in the way of sinners, nor sit in the seat of the scornful. But I will make my delight in the law of the Lord, and in his law I will meditate day and night. I am resolved what to do. Can the church say amen? So here it is. This is talking about not the preacher. This is talking about the lay member. It was talking about the preacher, Jesus Christ, who is the bishop of our soul in the earlier verse in Hebrews chapter 1. And collectively now he's speaking to the church. But now notice what you read here. This is talking about the ministry of the apostles to the laity, and that's you. And what is supposed to be the product of that? what is supposed to be the end run and the end game.